We'll do the first and last verse, blessed assurance.
Thank you. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen.
Ain't that good, Brother Ray?
The preacher's talking about him and Brother Jack having privilege. His church. I'm just glad we got two men of God that don't just walk and don't just talk the talk. They walk the walk.
Amen.
And I appreciate that.
I know it's all part
it just fills you up, runs your cup over, and gives you the happy bubbles, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Every now and then, I'm just like when I get the can't help it. I'm thankful for a place called heaven. I ain't been there yet, but I'm going. Glory. How many's glad you're going to heaven? Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And then, I'm thankful for the cross. How many believes in the cross?
Amen.
And if you don't believe in the cross, you may even say, amen. I didn't mean that to come across rude. That's just the truth. But I'm glad I know about heaven. I'm a going. Praise the Lord. The Bible tells me I am. And I'm thankful for the cross of Calvary. But preacher Jack, I'm glad I know Jesus.
Yeah.
Glory. Let me tell you something. I'm going to testify real quick. I used to be a big Garth Brooks fan. Big Garth Brooks fan. I wanted to be like him. I did. I probably come close to maybe it didn't mean it, but mean it bad towards the Lord. But I probably come close to idolizing him. I wanted shirts like his, and I wanted Wrangler jeans like his, and I wanted cowboy boots like him. I wanted to be Garth Brooks. In 1992, we drove all the way to Oklahoma just to see where he grew up.
Amen.
And to see the water tower. What mom and dad did done for me to take me there. But you know what? Had I met Garth Brooks in person, he might have been nice, and he might not have been. I don't know. And I've met a few famous people along the way. And maybe you have too. Sports stars, famous people. But you know that don't matter if you don't know Jesus. I mean, the greatest person I've ever met is the Lord Jesus Christ. And to know that the King of Glory lives inside of my heart. And lives inside of your heart, man alive. Praise the Lord. That ain't the message, but I'm feeling it right now. Praise the Lord. But have I told you where I'm preaching from tonight? Okay. We're in Exodus 14. Exodus 14. Boy, Sister Patsy, we've heard some good specials today in the Anchor Bowls. And what, Sister Lish, what's the name of that one? I believe. How many believes tonight? Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Don, it's one of them services where it gets so good, I have to go home and give me two ibuprofen. Amen. All right. Listen, I'm real excited about this message, and the reason being is I've preached a whole lot about the Red Sea crossing. I've put it in a lot of messages, but I've never, Sister Megan, just preached a message on the Red Sea crossing. And so I'm excited about what the Lord has given us tonight. Exodus 14, let's read. I tell us to do it this way. Exodus 14, verses 13 and 14 and 21 and 22. All right? The Bible says, Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. And the Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. Verse 21. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night. That's something right there. And made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children, by the way, I believe all this. Amen. I believe every bit of this. And the children of Israel went unto the midst of the sea upon the dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. Lord, help us tonight as we do our very best for you to preach this message. I'm excited about it. Lord, help me just to get it all out. What you put in my heart, and we'll praise your name. Do a work in this place and in our people. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I want to give you a thought. The title of this message would be the title from a song. Stand still and see God move. Stand still and see God move. Now, I want to read all this chapter and take up a whole lot of time because this is a very, very, very familiar passage of Scripture. You all know the story probably if you've been saved long at all. And as I began to read this and study this, the Lord just started giving me truths. And basically, they're popping off the page. And it's one of those that over the last few nights, I've been jotting down a few things as God's given me. And just super excited. So I'm going to give you three things by way of introduction. And this may be simplistic, but I believe it'll help us tonight. Number one, they had a predicament. They were in a predicament. Because before them was a great big sea, and behind them were some soldiers. That sea was a problem, and the soldiers were a problem. That's the predicament that they were in. A sea in front of them, and a sea of warriors, a sea of soldiers behind them. No place to go. So not only do I see the predicament that they were in, but I see the placement. A place where they were probably scared, and then a place where they were stuck. Where do you go? You can't go to the left. You can't go to the right. You can't go across the sea. And you can't retreat. You can't turn around. You can't go back. Because there's an army that's waiting to destroy you. And they're seeking you. And they're hot on the trail, as the old saying goes. But, you know, as I told Don today, as I thought about this point, Sister Kim, I got to thinking about how they felt hemmed in. And sometimes life will offer up a sea of problems, and it seems like the devil and all his soldiers are coming up behind you, and it seems like you're stuck. And sometimes, listen, Sister Joanne, I've been in some places before where I've been scared to death. And I mean, maybe physically, maybe mentally, I don't know, but just where a great fear had come upon me. And I remember the night. 5 years ago, when I was in the hospital and the tornadoes was around, Mama, I was afraid. I wasn't afraid to die, but in a way, I was afraid to die. I didn't know what was going on. Maybe you've been there. And sometimes life will hit us in. And then I thought about this. Not only the predicament, not only the placement, but then I thought about the power. God had power over the winds. Now, if you take notes, if you're one that takes notes, write this down. God has power over the winds. That means we can trust Him in all of life's storms. Not only does He have power over the winds, but God has power over the water. So that means we can trust Him in life's seas. And then not only power over the winds, and not only power over the water, but then there's power over those warriors. So that means we can trust Him in life's struggles. So He's got power over the wind. I can trust Him in the storms of life. He's got power over the water. I can trust Him in the seas of life. He's got power over the warriors. parting the sea. God separated the water. Now, I'll be honest, this verse, a lot of times when I put this or reference this account, this biblical story, Sister April, I preach a lot of it out of chapter number 14. But then, Brother Gary, I got to reading into chapter 15, and Sister Billy, God about blessed my socks off. Now, I want you to see something, how God parted the water. In Exodus 15, verse 8, and with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together, and the flood stood upright as a heap, and the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. So God, just by his breath, just by the beat of his nostrils, just by his power, not only does he separate the water, but then he stacks the water up. You know what I thought about? How many's ever faced a sea of problems? How many's ever felt like you was at a Red Sea crossing? And you didn't know how you was going to get across. But I'm glad that no matter what we face, no matter what problem we come up against, I'm glad that God just has to breathe on it. Sister Ginger, he's just got to look at it. And the sea and the problems of our life will be separated, and then he can stack them up. And then not only can he stack them up, but he can strengthen them. The Bible said to where they came from, the Bible says that they were congealed. I don't know what that word meant, but I thought yield. There's going to be something. You know what that means? They become as jello. Here, the sea separated, stacked up high on the right, stacked up high on the left, and congealed. I mean like jello. That you've heard me say this before, there's nothing too hard for God, nothing too big for God. I'm glad that he can take all the rough places. I'm glad he can take all the hard things. He can take all the strong things, and he can break it down, and he can make it wobbly, but make you strong to where you won't wobble in the face of the devil. Praise the Lord. So he separates the water. He stacks the water. What he does is unreal and unbelievable. And then he solidifies the water, makes it like jello. Number two, not only did I see him part the sea, but then he says, stand still and see the problem sink. Now, Sister Megan, I wrote this down. God gave it to me. And every now and then it gives me something I think, boy, I'm going to get a hold of Max Lucado and have that put in the book. The same waters that were a barricade for God's elect became a burial place for the Egyptians. The very same water. Listen, you think about Joseph when his brother sold him off into bondage and lied that he'd been killed. He said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. I think about that good scripture in Romans 8:28. For we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and those who are called according to his purpose. I'm telling you, sometimes things are bad. Oh, but God can turn around for our good. Sometimes things are ugly. So, I thought about how he can solve any problem, God can settle any problem, and he can smash any problem. I think about what he says there in Genesis 18, before Sarah, is anything too hard for God? In Jeremiah chapter number 32, he said, is anything too hard for the Lord? There's nothing too hard for God. There's nothing too big for God. He's able to do exceeding and abundantly above all. Think. Praise the Lord. Tonight you may be in a storm. Tonight you may be facing the sea. Tonight there might be some soldiers behind you ready to trample you and take you down. But hallelujah, God is able to separate. God is able to solve. God is able to fix. God is able to settle. God is able to strengthen you. All you've got to do is stand still and trust in the Lord. Amen. I have problems standing still. I am a fidgeter. I am. I do things here that don't even know. And folks will say, "Preacher," said, "Brother Grady can be leading singing, you walking back and forth and tapping on the wall and moving behind the chair and walking around talking to people, and I'm a fidgeter." And I know what happened. Brother Floyd and all the deacons, when they hear this, may be like a lynch mob. If you tied my feet and my hands together and made me stand behind that pulpit, I couldn't say a word. Brother Ariel, I see everybody right now with ropes and chains saying, "Let's take them down. Let's get them. We won't have to hear it. But spiritually speaking, that's a little humor. It's all the truth, amen. I'm a fidgeter. But the honest truth, sometimes I have a hard time standing still and letting God move in my life. Sometimes I want to look in to helping God. How many's ever tried to help God solve a problem? He don't need us. Amen. It's amazing. Isn't it amazing? How many times, Brother Grady, have you and I joked about when God does something in our life and we'll say, "Oh, God knows what He's doing, doesn't He?" Like it amazes us. Well, I'm telling you, He's able. He's able to do anything that He wants to do because He's God. I can't tell you how many times I've heard Don's daddy say He's God and He can do what He wants to do when He wants to do it. He's God. So, stand still and see and part the sea in your life. Stand still and see the problems sink in your life. Then stand still and see the powerful salvation of the Lord. The Bible says in Exodus 14:13, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. I thought about this. This is a message right here. A few points that I preached in a message one time on just the salvation of the Lord. And I believe, Brother Lee, that we can apply in this message into our lives. Number one, salvation saves sinful people. Now, I heard somebody say one time that if you try to say that we're not sinners, then we're lying to ourselves. And we're lying to God because we're all sinners. But I believe that if I could put it out like this, there's a difference in sinners and sinful people. We're all sinners saved by the grace of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We might think the wrong thing, do the wrong thing, say the wrong thing, but we ought not to practice a sinful lifestyle. And so, even though we're sinners saved by grace, we shouldn't be living and practicing a sinful life. Amen. The Bible says that if we willfully sin, there remaineth no more sacrifice. But if we sin and we come short of the glory of God, the Bible says that He is salvation saves sinful people, those who are lost. And if you're lost, you're losing. And if you're losing, you're lacking. Amen. Sinners, sinful people that don't know the Lord, they're lost. They're losing. They're lacking without the Lord. But not only powerful salvation, salvation saves sinful people, but it also saves spiritual people, those who pray and those who praise unto God. And then special people. I thought about how the children of Israel, God's elect, and Sister Teresa, I thought about how they were God's chosen people. They were precious in His sight. They were peculiar people, and they were His prized possession. He loves them so much that one day a nation is going to be reborn in a day. He ain't going to listen. I've heard preachers and God bless them. God will never turn His back on Israel. And I'm glad that God has never turned His back on us as Christians. Amen. I tell you, He can't bless America. He can't look on sin and bless America. But how many is glad that even in a country that has forgotten God, He has not forgotten His children, praise the Lord. Glory to God. So, I thought about, but you know what? You're precious too. You might not be a Jew, know any peculiar pastors? We know some crazy ones. I is one. Amen. And pride. Where his pride? Oh, let me tell you something. You know what I got to thank you about the other day? Give me some of the. I don't even know how you'd say it. Queen of England, Prince Charles, is that right? Prince William and all these. If somebody, Brother Tim, was coming to represent them, Sister Nell, I believe we're calling them ambassadors. If they come representing them, they're going to talk their best, love their best for the Lord. Or for whoever. But you know what? We're ambassadors for the Lord. Amen. We're representing a king. We're representing, Brother Paul, I'm feeling it right now, brother. We're representing the king of all kings. He said in Revelation 21, he said, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first and the last. And he said, I'll be their God and they'll be my people. I'm telling you, I'm glad. Right now, I'm a citizen of the United States of America. Listen, the Bible says, let your conversation be in heaven. No, right now, mentally, I'm already in glory. Amen. It'd be all right physically if I was already in glory. I'm telling you right now, I'm glad. I'm glad that I represent the King. I'm glad I'm heading to the country. I want to do my best to be an ambassador. Amen. He says that we're heirs and joint heirs. He said that we're like a precious jewel. Amen. Listen, he likens us unto precious rubies. He is likening us unto diamonds. I'm telling you, you're worth so much. He gave his life for you. Jesus paid it all. Salvation also, not only for sinful people, not only for the spiritual people, not only for special people, but for sick people. There's people who need help, and there's people who need hope. Amen. And then, we stand still, see and part the sea. Stand still, see the problem sink. Stand still and see His powerful salvation. And fourth and lastly, and I'm glad this is the last point, praise the Lord. Stand still and see people sing. Now, I got to looking over this, Brother Jack, and I got excited. I got so excited I went and got down up out of bed this afternoon. He said, come downstairs, I'm going to tell you about this. And in Exodus 15, verse 1, then, hold on. Yes. Exodus 15, verse 1. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. Now, Sister Lisa, if we took that and we paralleled it to Brother Jackson's scripture in Revelation, I studied this out in typology, but it got me excited, Brother Jim. Just think about one day. Bible talks about the pale horse, red horse, black horse. And what, listen, let me give it to you this way. I read Exodus 15, verse 1, and then I want you to read with me, if you want to, Revelation 15, verse number 3. Revelation 15, verse number 3. Well, I tell you this, let me start at verse 1. I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. Seven angels having seven last plagues, for in them is filled up the wrath of God. I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire. And them that had gotten the victory, praise the Lord, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark,
tell you this, and then, amen. If you want to shout, you shout, because this is good right here. Praise the Lord. As they were facing the Red Sea, and Pharaoh and his army has attracted them down. Boy, they's in a dilemma. Surrounded by danger, but then God breathed, and the sea was divided. And they crossed on dry land. And after they got across the other side, God in heaven destroyed and swallowed up Pharaoh and his mighty army. They had a dilemma. They were surrounded by dangers, but they were delivered. And Brother Eddie, where was the enemy thrown? Into the depths of the sea. One of these days, Brother Gray, happy day, happy day, happy day. Satan, sin, sorrow, sickness, storms, all that's going to be over with. God in heaven is going to take the devil, the Antichrist, the false prophet, the beast, the fallen angels, and hell itself, and cast them all into the lake of fire forever and ever and ever. Glory. We might have a dilemma right now. It might get dangerous right now. It might seem like we're stuck right now, and we're hemmed in, but I'm telling you, deliverance is coming. Praise the Lord. Deliverance is coming. I say hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Just as they were delivered and the enemy was destroyed, one of these days, our enemy is going to be destroyed and we're going to be delivered. And you know what? We're going to sing a song. Sister Bertha, that even the angels cannot sing. See, the angels can't sing the song of the redeemed. Praise the Lord, but we can. I am redeemed by blood divine. Glory, glory, Christ is mine. Over to Him. I now resign. I have been redeemed. Praise the Lord. How many has been redeemed tonight? Amen. Glory. Let's stand all over the church house. Lord, we love you. It's good to be blood-bought. Good to be redeemed. Lord, thank you, Father, for going before us and dividing the seas in our lives. Seas of doubt, seas of worry, seas of depression. These things that can bring on spiritual strokes and can take our joy and faith and all that. Lord, I'm thankful, Lord, that you can stack them, and then Lord, you can tear them down, and Lord, you can deliver us from evil. And as King David said, so shall I be saved from mine enemies. Thank you, Lord, for saving us from our enemy, the devil. Tonight, we don't have to go to hell, but we get to go to heaven because of your marvelous grace. My prayer is that if there's anyone here tonight that doesn't know Jesus, I pray that this would be the night they get born again. If there's anyone here tonight not where they need to be, I pray that this would be the hour and the time that they get things fixed up with the darling Lamb of Heaven. And then, Lord, if there's one here tonight that is facing a Red Sea in their life, I pray, Father, that you part the waters for them and give them an easy place to cross. We'll give you praise. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
104, hymn 104.